hair. Okay. As always, not always, but I'm going to talk about Johnny later. But, oh yeah, I wanted to just play the song that he posted on Instagram. I know this is kind of old news, but I was listening to it today. It's pretty cool. Johnny singing, Johnny. It's pretty good. He posted on Instagram a long time ago, so I guess I can play it. And it's called Give Us the Truth. I think it's pretty powerful that he actually covered this song. Of all the things he could cover, he covered this one. It's pretty good. Just keep listening to it. I thought that was like so cool that he covered that song, man. Not gonna talk about Johnny and Amber. I'm gonna talk about Manson. But I wanted to play that song because, we can talk about Johnny too, I guess, because it's all related. I really think this whole thing, the Amber Heard thing, really is affecting Amber Heard and Esme Bianco against Manson really, really bad. Because people, not just people on YouTube, but people out there. You know, anybody's like, a lot of people don't believe Amber. They think she fabricated the whole thing, photoshopped the bruise. So now they're trying to cancel Manson. And I think it's the fact that Amber happened last year, they went the son won and the whole thing. And then Johnny's doing defamation and it's not going to be on court until 2022. But the fact that that got so big. So now women look like freaking liars, which sometimes they can be, just like men can be. And I don't think even Roger Wood and Esme Bianco knew this was going to happen 2 years ago when they first started the position, because it was 2 years ago. There's a couple of things with her. I keep on her because she's like the biggest. She's the one that started the whole thing, but if she wouldn't have started, somebody else would have started. Because I think they're really, my opinion of this is that they're really trying to get him, and he's an easy target, just like Johnny was and still is. So what's best than just go from her own mouth and the things that she said through the years and many interviews, as I was thinking about what she said about herself and about her upbringing and her family. And there's a thing that struck me as very curious about Evan Rocha Wood, when she talked about her childhood being like she had a great time. Mom and dad were acting coaches. Her dad owned a theater. You know, she comes from that background. She really didn't have to do any like regular job like we all do ever, because she went from like playing in the house to just being commercials and being in movies, which is great. Like that's just, but she's being lucky. She has a very privileged life, and that's since she was a kid. So when she talks about, she was so innocent and she didn't know that people were doing drugs around her, which this is from her deposition in 2016. And then she didn't know the Manson was doing drugs. She didn't know what's going on, that the environment was so dark. I go back to things that she said through the years and think about the way that she was raised and think about when she started working in Hollywood when she was 10 years old. And I don't buy it for a second that she didn't know that people do drugs in LA. I don't buy it for a second that she didn't see the darkness of this freaking town before she was with Manson. I don't think she was so innocent. I know she was really young, but that doesn't mean you're innocent, just you're young. The fact that she made that movie 13 when she was 16, she talks in interviews about when she made that movie, her mom was on board, dad was on board. They didn't think it was dirty. In the movie, she is a girl who finds out that she likes her friend, so they're really gonna get together. So she's bisexual. She does ecstasy in the movie. She gets punched in the face in the movie. She's rebellious. She yells at her mom. She curses at a lot, and she, you know, she's doing all these things that teenagers sometimes do. She made the movie. Her mom accompanied her to make the movie. When you're a minor, you just don't go in Hollywood and just walk in and do your job. You have to go with your parents. That's why she ended up being homeschooled, because she was working in movies. So this whole thing about her not having any idea about what's going on around her and being this very light as a feather person that doesn't any understand darkness, I find it hard to believe, because she was faced with it since the first moment that she started working in the film industry. There is nothing innocent or naive about Hollywood at all. And from somebody who's been making commercials and movies since she was 10 years old, I just don't buy it that she was so innocent. There's no way. You see a child stars like Demi Lovato and Selena Gomez and Britney and all these people that work since they were little kids, and they all have the same story. They tell you how dark it was and how much of like perverts around the world, and they don't try to be innocent. They don't try to seem innocent. Why is it that Amy Roger Wood is trying to do that? Because it fits her narrative and it fits all the stuff that she's been making up to this point. But there's many interviews that she contradicts herself so much. And this is not because she's stupid or because she never got abused, because maybe she did. It's because she's just doesn't have a fixed personality. She doesn't have a fixed personality. Like many actors, you know, they're blank. They're blank slates. So you can just put your paint on them and they can act, and they're wonderful at what they do. And she's a really good actress. But that gives you more of my thought is that she doesn't have a fixed personality. What I meant to say with this is she's been kind of trained since she was a kid to kind of direct, follow around and become somebody else. And then when she was with Manson, she was looking all vintagey and really pretty. And she is very pale, but she made that even more evident. And the red lipstick and the 1940s hair and the vintage style. Okay. Then she was with the girl she was with after, and then she was wearing the dress pants and the suspenders and cut her hair. Then she was with Jamie Bell, which is her ex-husband, which she never talks about him, which is very interesting. I don't know why she never talks about him at all, in a good light or bad light at all. And then she was all feminine again. And now she's back into the other thing. What I'm trying to say is that she mimics the person she is with. And a lot of us do that, but that's her problem. So when she talks about how he changed her, and he made her into something she's not, and he dictated the way she dressed and the way she looked. No. Because she's been doing this since she was a kid. She's been mimicking all the people, and she doesn't really have a fixed personality. So she is sucking into whoever she is with. This reminds me of Amber Heard and how Amber did the same thing. When she was with Johnny, she started being like all bohemian. She looked more bohemian, and she talked about poetry and things that you've never heard her talking about that before, ever. And she even started looking like him. Like, she wore the hat that Johnny was wearing, the bracelets, the just bohemian look, okay? When she was with him. When she was with the girlfriend she was before that got actually was violent with her and got arrested for like a night or two, she was very tomboyish, masculine. And then she got with Johnny, and then she was bohemian. And then after Johnny, she was with for a brief time with Elon Musk. And how are you going to look like when you are with the dude that is a trillionaire, Elon Musk, the most powerful, if it's not the most powerful, man or American, not in the world. I mean, in America. Of course, she was all glamorous. She got the real lipstick on. I'm not hating. I got real lipstick, okay? She was all glamorous, and she changed a lot. So these women do this. They mimic the person they are with. And so for them to just come back saying, oh, yeah, he made me wear short dresses all the time. He made me wear high heels all the time. And again, we go to from Evan, we go to Esme Bianco. Esme Bianco is the second person with the big lawsuit, and she just filed a lawsuit 2 days ago. And yesterday, Manson's lawyer popped out. And he made a difference that a lot of people don't know about a civil lawsuit and a criminal lawsuit. What they're having right now is a civil lawsuit. So pretty much what it is that they asked for a bunch of money, Esme Bianco and her lawyer, bunch of money, I don't know how much, and Manson and whoever else team was like, no, hell no. So they say no to what she was asking. This was on page 6 in Rolling Stone magazine online yesterday. Because they say no to what she was asking, now she's filing a lawsuit. She lost me a long time ago, but that makes it look more greedy, makes her look less of a feminist, less of a victim. I mean, she is just trying to get money now to this point. I didn't know she was trying to get money. I thought she was mad at the guy and she just wanted revenge. She has this victim mentality and she just wanted attention. But now I see that it's about money. I really didn't know. I guess I'm too innocent for that. Anyway, so now his lawyer is saying that they're going to go to trial. I mean, he didn't say that. He said, just paraphrasing, he said, we will prevail with the truth. It really was a breath of fresh air to hear from his lawyer, even if it's not him, Manson, talking, but his lawyer saying something. I think it's a step, baby steps forward. So Esme's another person. She also says that he changed her, that he tried to change her, that he told her to wear high heels and short dresses and only lingerie and only underwear in the house the whole time. Okay. That's more BS. Esme Bianco had that look way before Manson and after Manson. And right now, maybe she goes around wearing her suit and her hair in a bun, no makeup, and trying to be all innocent. But way before when they met, she was a fetish model. She probably still is. We don't know about it. She was a fetish model. She was selling latex boots and gloves and dresses. And there's nothing wrong with being a fetish model. But you can't say that the guy was making you wear underwear in the house and high heels only if you were selling latex boots and high heels and you were a model and you were just into the lifestyle. And she was going to the Torture Garden, which is a place that people go to. It's not necessarily sexual, but you go there and they establish boundaries with somebody and there's a contract and you can whip somebody out, or they can whip you. Nobody goes to jail. It's a very safe environment. And she was going to the Torture Garden a lot. And this is not me making it up. There's plenty of flyers online and videos, not videos, but pictures of her at the Torture Garden in LA. So and my point is, he didn't change anybody. If there was anything, there's anything going on with them and why they felt abused, or why they feel the need to throw this guy under the bus, through the mud, it has something to do with themselves as people and with their brain. It was like that before they even got with him. This is what I really think. I think they mimic people. I think they have no personalities, so they just turn into whoever they happen to be with. And it gets you tons of attention, and it validates you as a person, and then you feel all good. Not to say that she never got this happening to her. Well, my theory is that these things maybe happened to her, but not by him. She was married with the other guy that she has a son, a kid with. She also never talks about her son and her ex-husband. like she's only been with one person her whole life. They traumatized her to the point of so much pain, and that person is Manson. She, none of the other people she's been with did anything bad to her. See, that's like, it's very, I don't buy it. So I wanted to play some, an interview from her, because this is more of what I'm trying to say, that she is addicted to being a victim. I didn't know why people getting awards from being bisexual. That's like me getting an award from being a single mother, or being a mother, or being Italian. I want to know. I want an award because I'm Italian, you know. Or I'm an award. I want an award because I'm straight. Why is she getting recognized being like being bisexual? It's not such a big deal, right? 21st century. Everything that she talks about, that she is about, is just glorifying herself and whatever lifestyle she happened to be on. Now it's bisexual. Later she's going to be straight. In 10 years she's going to be bisexual again. I don't know. But it just seems like this is from a festival. Let me see.
You from Touched by an Angel.
I'm just going to go back. Sorry, hold on.
We were the youngest same-sex kiss on television at the time. Yeah. And
this is from a interview that she did in, I think, Cannes, a film festival, and the lady just asked her about the show that she was on. It was called Touched by an Angel. And in this show, she was 12 years old when she did the show, and it was a same-sex couple. This is more of what I'm trying to say, that she is not innocent, that she grew up in North Carolina and then in Hollywood, have her teenage years here. Nobody that is on that environment is innocent. You can't tell me that you never see somebody doing drugs in front of you when you work in the film industry. So more of this is to show that what I think is that she's either full of it, or she just really has a weird memory, or she really believes this about herself. That would be a bigger problem if she really does believe it. Because in many interviews, she talks about how progressive her mom was and how she grew up with all these super open-minded people, actors, and she made a TV show and a movie where she plays bisexual girls that does a little bit of ecstasy and drugs. And then she just talks about like she didn't know that this existed. And you can't access a role if you're an actor. You can't be around these things as a human and not see them around you in Hollywood. I just don't buy it. So now she's glorifying her own work when she was 10 years old. I love about Emily Roger Wood is that she takes everything as she invented it. Like she invented being bisexual, you know, or getting abused. She invented being a musical theater kid. She glorifies herself so much. We remember who started the whole thing and who did the video Justify My Love and the sex book in the 90s. Madonna. Madonna was the biggest person back, maybe not anymore, but back then I'll look up to her because she was so open-minded about everything. And Madonna was talking about being bisexual way before this chick. So why she's acting like she's some type of champion just because she's bisexual or because she was abused, maybe by other people. I think that she really believes her bullshit, or she's in out there to get everybody's, I don't know, but it's very strange. It's very strange because I think that she has no personality, and that's very dangerous because that means that she can make any type of lie. She can be with next girlfriend or boyfriend or husband in 2 years and make more lies and mimic them and turn into them and then say that they're trying to change her when she's the one that was mimicking the people that she was with. It's very dangerous if she's going through the whole, she's following the Amber Heard tutorial. That's just like pathological lying. And there's a lot of things that I'm not going to just believe just because she said them. And I'm not saying this because she's an actress or because she's a woman. I will say this about anybody. I'm not going to just believe you because you say it. So haven't seen anything besides what she says. And she contradicts herself with her own words so much through the years. And I don't think that people sit down and actually watch this many times of many interviews she has done. My last video that I posted yesterday was her, it was very short because she was saying a rape joke can be a good joke. She said, I can laugh at a rape joke if it's a good joke. And that's her voice, her saying that stuff and stuff. So I'm saying that she's either clueless. I don't think she's this evil mastermind. I think she's either clueless or she believes her own bullshit that will make her delusional and insane. And how can she say that she can laugh at a rape joke? I never heard anybody who ever been raped or abused in any way saying, well, it's kind of cool. I mean, if it's a good comedian and if it's a good joke, I'll laugh at it. Especially knowing that people are going to talk about it, about the stupid shit that you just said on that TV show, because you're famous and you're supposed to have this platform. Why won't you watch what you're saying? It's very strange. She said that in 2019 in a TV show. She said that she can laugh if it's the right joke. How can it be the right joke if it's about rape? You know, I mean, I can't laugh. I just can't. So it seems that she can. So here she's talking about she was the first. This was the first same-sex kiss by two girls on television ever. Well, I don't know if it's true or not. I'm going to believe that it's true. Maybe not. And she's bragging about it. And I keep thinking about Madonna and what Madonna did for pretty much a big sexual revolution in the 90s when she came up with her short hair and the whips and the fetish stuff. And her videos were like, the video Justify My Love was so out there. It was so hot and so sexy that she got banned. That video got banned from MTV. You know you're doing something right when you get banned from MTV or from Pepsi and all that stuff. So Madonna back then, she was doing that, and she was the first one that was doing that, not her. So I don't know why she's taking on that role. But anyway, so this is her blowing her own horn.
That episode was also banned in West Virginia. They were not allowed.
The episode was banned. Had to be banned. Because she kissed some girl on the episode. So she, instead of saying that, talking about, you know, the other actress that did it with her, the scene with her, talking about this show, she goes straight to the fact of how revolutionary this is. It was so bad that it got banned. This is just the way that she just comes across so arrogant to me. And this is not something that I think now, because of the allegations. I think I've been thinking this since she came out with the whole allegations years ago, when she was posting over and over on Instagram how much of a bisexual person she is. I was already annoyed by it. So it's not that I'm annoyed by it now. Not like she cares. Nobody cares. I'm just saying. So it was banned. The episode she did was banned. Yeah, because she had experience in Hollywood, enough experience in Hollywood to pretend. What actors do is they pretend. To pretend to be bisexual and kiss another girl, right? And she was doing all these movies and this stuff. But when she was with Manson, she had no idea about drugs or sex or nothing. She was innocent. It doesn't make no sense. No, she's trying to be like, she was trying to come across like the shelter girl from the Midwest. Yeah, maybe she was back then. But once she moved to LA, she moved with her mom so she can go to auditions and work. And you start going to work and your work is a movie set every day, every other day. You're not innocent anymore. You've seen things. And then again, I'm going to just go back to Britney Spears or Corey Feldman, Selena Gomez, Demi Lovato, and they all have some type of mental problem because of how they were doing these things since they were children. And they probably shouldn't. They probably should just be out there being children instead of just being, you know, kissing people on TV. I don't know. But they all agree about the same thing. All these people I just named, about how dark everything is in Hollywood and about how perverse and morbid and dark it is, and the drugs and the addiction. So how come it was really dark for Demi Lovato? Lindsay Lohan. I was trying to think about Lindsay Lohan. It was very dark for Lindsay Lohan and very dark for all these people, but not for her. She did not know. She went through it and completely innocent. No way.
To air it.
Woohoo. Just in West Virginia?
Yeah. But it's amazing to experience that as a teenager and then kind of see where we are now and how television's changed so much. It's really cool. It might not seem like we're making progress, but we are slowly.
We are. Who is we? Is her as an artist, or is her and all the other people in the world that happen to be gay or bi? Who's we? What is it with this mentality of these people always trying to, like, it's like they're running for a campaign for president or something. Who is we? But see, she said it right there.
That
it was pretty cool. It was pretty cool. She was aware of that. It was pretty cool. She was not innocent about it.
The producers called me and my mother into the office and sat us down and just said, you know, we're thinking of having Jesse get a crush on a girl. And I think we were, you know, again, a pretty open-minded household. They were theater actors, so.
A pretty open-minded household, you know, the mom and dad were theater actors. Yeah. That's the part I do believe about the stuff she says. She grew up with actors. Then not only that, but then they moved here to California, and then she started going to all these auditions and the commercials and movies. There's no way that she was innocent about sex and drugs and addictions. It's everywhere. You go to the bathroom and somebody's doing a line. You turn around and somebody is slamming something on their arm. You just go to 7-Eleven to get a slushy coffee and somebody smoking meth. That's how it is, and that's how it is for normal people, the nobodies like me. Imagine for her the things that she's seen since she was a kid. You can't tell me then after in 2016 on your deposition in Congress that you have no idea what's going around you because you never seen it before. Because she said that she said she never seen drugs before, so she didn't know the man was doing drugs. Even if, yeah, right? Yeah, like drugs are like the worst thing that he's done. Yeah, probably it is. I think the worst thing he's done is probably drugs. That's it. I don't think he did everything else that he's accused to do. And drugs are just, you know, he's just hurting himself. He's not hurting anybody else. Can we say that it's kind of crappy that he does a lot of drugs? Maybe. He seems like a great host to me. Because, I mean, these people just keep saying the same thing. I was over his house, and he kept me awake all night, and he fed me drugs. Yeah, I don't know. Again, nobody can force you to do cocaine. I said that in a different video. Nobody can force you to do cocaine up your nose. It's very hard to force, I would think. Yeah, I don't think it's possible. So then she goes again with the... She's saying right there, it was a pretty open-minded household. They were theater actors, mom and dad.
This is not shocking to them. And my mom was really supportive. Honestly, I have to give a shout-out to my mom at this as well, because I have been doing this since I was five. And she...
Since she was five. She's been acting since she was five.
Drove me everywhere, stayed on set with me, drove me to the auditions. She was an acting coach. And she allowed me to do these roles and these, you know, she didn't judge, and she understood the gravity of them, and she understood why they were important. So, you know, while I'm doing Once and Again and 13 and stuff like that, like, my mom was right there, but also letting it happen and letting me do that. So I have to kind of give it up to her too for that.
Letting me do that. I think her mom is awesome. Give it a shot to your mom too, Evan, because it's pretty cool that she was supportive and she left her life in North Carolina just to be here with you and drive you around to auditions. I think that's cool. It's cool. I think her parents were cool. The one thing that they didn't teach her is to be honest, I guess. Or maybe she was. And then so many years, like she said, acting as she was 5 years old, so many years of being in the industry and just and messed up situations happening, they can turn you into a pathological liar. You can be delusional. It's either two things. She's either delusional, she believes her stuff, she believes what she's saying. That'll be really dangerous that she does, because that means that she will go to any length. When somebody really believes, it's, you know, it's like a person who is religious, and not just spiritual religious, but like really hardcore fanatics, you know. They really believe. They go to war with that. So this is what I think this is going on with Roger Wood. She really believes this happened to her with Manson. Again, I'm not saying that it didn't happen to her at all. And she really believes that he groomed her and he taught her what to do, when to eat, when to sleep. She really believes it. So if she really believes it, she's going to make everybody believe it. And she's a good actress. So my worry is that when they go to trial, because they're going to go to trial, he might lose. Just like, you know, like Johnny Depp and Johnny Depp did in the UK last year. Because they believe it's so hardcore that I think if you have the good representation and the good, you know, lawyers and a good, maybe good luck, you can make a case out of this. I mean, there's a lot of people that don't believe her here on YouTube. A lot of people believe Manson is innocent and Johnny is innocent. There's money raised on Johnny is innocent. I mean, there's like they raised a thing like $40,000. There's a really great, great community to think these two dudes are innocent. But there's a lot of people, though not on YouTube, they do think that these two are the devil. Johnny got blocked by Netflix. I read this morning his role in the Addams Family project. And I hope they don't do that. I mean, I'm not watching Netflix ever again if they do that. I think that if you say you like Johnny Depp or if you like Manson, then I'm not saying go listen to Marilyn Manson right now. I'm not saying that. But like, stop supporting the other people. Like, I'm not gonna watch Aquaman, even if she's on it, she's not on it. I'm not watching anything with her on it. I'm not watching Westworld anymore. I'm not watching anything with her on it, because otherwise I'd be a hypocrite if I sit here and say all this stuff and then I just go and support her projects. But I am going to support the other two, even if I don't like the music that Manson makes these days. Or if I don't like Pirates of the Caribbean, I hate those movies. But I'm going to still support it if he gets it back, which I don't think he will get it back. But whatever. Is I think that the notion of they have a lot of money so they don't need to work and they don't need support is pretty ignorant. And I don't think that we should think like that. So they do need it. So the most people talk about this, even on YouTube, Instagram, whatever, I think it's a good conversation. And we have to open the conversation of this victimhood. You know, it's like it gets you more attention. It does. And now I found this. I don't know how I found this. This is really weird. But this interview of Marilyn Manson hits right on the nail of what I'm talking about. So I'm just going to play it just for the sake of listening to his voice. And also because he just said the thing about being a villain and being a hero. He's actually promoting Born Villain. This is in 2016. This is an interview. It was a 30-minute interview. I'm not going to play it, but I'm going to play only this part about he's talking about being not being a victim, being a villain. And it's kind of what the same way I see it. Which I'm not surprised, because we usually agree on things.
Speaking of Bond villain, what were you like as a teenager?
Well, I was always a bad kid in a sense, but I was always shy. But, you know, I went to Christian school. And of course, when the title Born Villain does raise a question of nature versus nurture. And I always identified with the villain in any story because it's the person who creates change, catalysts in any movie or any book. It's the person who causes a change. And, you know, they're bad people. and they're good heroes, but heroes are never the most important person in any movie, even though it's the person that is easiest to like. And I think that that's really mediocre. And then sort of explain
that is really mediocre, right? It's crazy that he's saying it right there. This is like 4 years, 5 years ago. How the villains are the ones that bring the chaos, and the chaos are the ones, chaos is what brings change. Nothing can change if somebody doesn't stir the pot. So it's what's happening now with Amber Heard and Johnny and him and all the chicks. This is what's happening now. They're stirring the pot in a way that it can be really good for certain groups of people, and it can be very damaging for other people, for the people that did got raped and assault and abuse and human trafficked, the people that did have those things happening to them. It's damaging because then they compare you with like, oh yeah, you got this happening to you. Oh, I heard even Richard Wood had the same problem. And don't put me on that. Don't put me in the shelf next to her, because I think she's a liar. So it, at the same time, it's like, it's shaming who actually had real problems. You know, hopefully people start going to believe the girls and the boys and the guys and the males and the females that do get abused, and they go and say it, not on TV, but on Instagram, but in real life. And they go to court and say, hey, I need a restraining order. Hopefully they will believe, and not just like from now on, well, you know what, all these people in Hollywood are lying and making hoax and conspiracies. So we're not going to, so now you put me in the same shelf that you put in me next to Amber Heard. And my bruise is not going to be real, because her bruise wasn't real. I really don't want that to happen. That will suck. So yes, like he's saying, you stir in the pot, you're making change happen when you're a villain. You can't do it if you are the hero. So this guy, I mean, you know, what do you expect? I mean, like, what do you expect from him? He is going to give you that. He's been doing that gig for 30 years, 25 years or so. He's been shocking people. He's been saying, sometimes he says the wrong thing on purpose. Sometimes he says it because he's kind of drunk. Sometimes he hits it right in the nail, like right there. Sometimes he sounds very smart. Sometimes he doesn't. He is not the president of the United States. He's not a lawyer. He's not your doctor. He is a rock star, and that's kind of what they do. So when she says that she didn't know he was doing drugs, when Esme Bianco says that she didn't know what was going on when he got her for a music video, did you watch his other music videos, lady? Like, seriously? Like, she didn't know what was going to happen. She didn't know what he was going to be about. I mean, it's been so obvious. He's been on your face for the last 25 years about it. And I think that as much as we can like him or not like him, he did a good career of himself as being the villain and being a shocker and trying to create change. This is not the first time that he will go to court for something he didn't do. I mean, this happened before, and he was blamed for anything under the sun. Something so big as a school shooting that kids die, a big freaking, probably one of the most horrible things that happened here. And he was blamed for it because the kids had a Manson shirt, and then they went to the kids' house, the Columbine, and they were fans of Ozzy Osbourne and Alice Cooper and Manson. So gotta be their fault. Gotta be their fault. It was either the rock and roll that was evil or the video games that were playing. It's never on the person. It's never the responsibility on you. Evan Rachel Wood, Esme Bianco. It's never about you saying no, about you trying to make a change without throwing somebody under the bus. Why it has to be about you being a victim. I don't think all that stuff happened. I think some stuff happened, but it wasn't like he posted on Instagram horrible distortions of the truth. He says it right there in a little paragraph. He says it right there. Horrible distortions of the truth. Of what happened. So what happened maybe happened, but they molded like it was freaking, you know, pizza dough. They molded to fit their agenda. And Amber Roger Wood has this agenda for a long time about her being out there, and not for the work that she does as an actress, but winning awards for being out there with her sexuality. Why is that awarded? It's just sexual. It's your business. It's all of us. We're different. What is it? I'm going to get an award for being straight. I'm going to get an award from having red hair that is fake. I'm going to get an award from being a mother. Why I think I'm more important? She does. And that's very problematic that she thinks that way. And that's what it got us to this point. Because she thinks that she's more special than any other domestic abuse victim. Even the ones that are in the same case, she's not siding with any of them. It's just all about her. And that shows you what she's trying to go for. It's not about, I never seen her. I watch a lot of documents and look at documents and videos of her, talks that she did in Europe and here, interviews. I never saw her once given resources. Never once. I never heard the same with, well, Amber was actually doing that a little bit, activism. Amber tried to do it. I never saw this one doing it. I never saw Esme Bianco doing it. I saw Esme Bianco going to the women march and doing this, like she's like a Black Panther member or something. I don't know why everybody's doing this. Why are you doing that? What are you trying to show? What are you doing that? Like, it's so freaking stupid. I don't see them actually trying to make a change for domestic violence. I don't see them having going to Oprah and saying, okay, let's talk about domestic violence. Not in Hollywood to us, poor girl. In the world, out there, in the real world, not in Hollywood, on the music business, on the film industry, in the music industry. They don't do that. They're not out there to help people. It's just about themselves because she doesn't have a personality. That's why she needs to make stuff up. So she, I think what's happening is that she's freaking bored. I think they're all bored. And they're like on Instagram, you know, going like, okay, what can I post today? Okay, who can I take down with me? Who can I get canceled? Dangerous. That is very, what's happening is not, we can just make videos and try to laugh about it. But if these things actually continue and Amy Roger Wood, Esme Bianco and company and Amber Heard, they keep winning. And that shows you that there's something that is going on that it needs to change. That is this bias about men don't get abused, men don't get punched, they do. Men don't get raped, they do. So what I'm saying is just don't believe everything that she's saying or that she's posting out there just because it's in Roger Wood. Just don't take it at face value. Imagine that it's your neighbor saying it, the girl next door that you knew your whole life. Imagine it's her saying it and see if you will believe her, not this person who is famous, who you already have a perception of. Manson, we have this perception of Manson. I think nobody can believe. I think it's hard for people to believe that Manson is a good guy. He might be a good guy. It's hard for people to see him as he's shy and he's kind of clumsy. And he is a person who's always in relationships. He was married. Now he's married right now. So he's married twice already. He's usually on these long relationships. I think he's pretty much a relationship guy. And they're making it look like he's this sexual, deviant, predator, shark, monster. Like he has to get a girl from the UK. Esme Bianco, now I'm jumping all the place. He has to bring her here to make a video, to make a bondage video, because Manson cannot get a girl from California, go like, hey, I'm the girl from a video that, yeah, I'm going to tie her up. You think that he cannot do that? He has to just request her and fly her over. Come on, give me a break. That's another thing that don't make no sense to me about her accusations about how she felt. No, she didn't feel. How she's accusing him of human trafficking. Of the pretense to make a video. He was making a video. He was going to make a video. And then it didn't happen because in the music industry or anything in the entertainment business like that, sometimes stuff doesn't happen. How many times you hear, oh my God, Yara Yara is going to make a movie about this. And then it just goes to shit. And then they don't do it. It's the same thing with music. He was going to make this video, I Want to Kill You, like they do in the movies. And he didn't make the video. He was going to make this movie, Phantasmagoria, based on the life of Lewis Carroll, the guy who wrote Alice in Wonderland, which happens to be my favorite book of all times. And then the project went to shit and it didn't happen. Not because he's a rapist, not because he was hurting her so much, and then they couldn't finish the video, which is what she's saying. She's saying, we couldn't finish the video. He got me for 4 days, no food and no sleep for 4 days, just making this video. I think if he really wanted to hurt somebody in a video, he doesn't have to get you, Esme, from the UK, fly you here just for that. That's so dumb. That's so dumb. That little detail right there, it's like, I mean, like, seriously? So that stuff like that, it gets me. The fact that she thinks she's been human trafficked. He was literally making a video and he liked her for some reason and he just wanted her on the video. That's not. That's casting. It's called casting process. It's not called human trafficking. There's more of even Rachel Wood talking about how difficult it is to be bisexual in this modern world. Like, she's talking about, like, we're in the 1800s or something. I find her so funny when she gets, like, political. It's hilarious.
Feelings start to take over, and I felt something that I couldn't explain. And it was something that made my throat close up and my stomach clench.
Oh, God.
Something that made my mouth go dry and my pulse race.
See how she... Did you see how she's talking? She's only saying... She's, human rights campaign, she's talking about the first time that she felt something for another girl. She was like, oh my God, I like this girl. That's it, I like this girl. And she's talking about it like she discovered the vaccine, you know, that she discovered the cure for coronavirus. She's talking about she discovered a freaking country and she reinvented the wheel because she felt attraction for another woman.
And it was something so simple, yet so terrifying. I thought women were beautiful.
Why? What are you clapping? These people, Hollywood is insane. Why? Would I go and get a clap if I go and say, hey, I'm straight? Cricket. Straight. What does it make me? Makes me a better person. It makes you a better person because you're bi or because I'm straight. Makes me good or bad. It's ignorance. And she's banking. She's been banking on this for years. This is before the Manson allegations. She was already banking on this over and over.
And I had no way to put what I felt into words. I had no role model.
She was just talking about how supportive her mom was. And how she was doing this movie since she was 10 years old. And they were super open-minded. And now she's saying she had no role model. There you go with the little, I wish I can show her face, with a little victim, innocent thing again. Like, she's Alice in Wonderland. She doesn't know what's going on.
No one I knew was talking about it. I wasn't exposed.
Oh, my God. She was exposed to it. She was very exposed to it. Since she was a child, because of the movies she was making and because of the environment she was at, she was exposed to it. Why did she say she was not exposed to it? This is a human rights thing that she did like a couple years ago.
So the only thing that I knew was fear and confusion and loneliness.
Oh my God. She made a movie, her first big movie called 13. It's a great movie. She's playing a girl who starts liking her girlfriend, her friend, and starts having feelings for her friend. I'm like, my God, I like you. Like, what's up? And we're both girls and we like each other. That is in the movie. Like, that's the main thing in the movie. It's like the reveal is, and there's drugs and there's rebelling against your mother. So there's a lot of things in the movie, but the core of it is, of the movie 13, is her character experimenting with things and navigating a different, being bisexual. So what is she saying that she doesn't know? She was lonely and confused. She never heard about it before. She never saw it before.
How can you be who you are when you don't understand what you're feeling?
Why, Evan, do you don't understand what you're feeling? You made a whole movie about the same thing. Did you read the script or like they, what? Who was it? And that's like the girl who played Reagan in The Exorcist back in the 70s saying, oh, I don't know who God was, or the devil. Yes, you did. Yes, you did. You were acting like you were possessed. So I'm not comparing being bisexual to being possessed by the devil. No. I'm saying that he is not believable because the way she's bringing herself up to failure with all these contradictions. In one interview, she's saying that she was super open-minded since she was a kid. Parents are actors. The whole thing, right? Supportive household. Parents are actors. Made my first movie and act as a bisexual girl in my first movie. All cool. Now she's saying she didn't know. She was not exposed to it. She felt lonely and scared because she didn't know. She was not exposed to it. That part got me. She was not exposed to it. You were in Hollywood. You were exposed to it. Like, seriously. I mean.
And the more I kept silent, the more my self-esteem got lower and lower and lower. And then one day, I heard an actress say the word bisexual. And I thought, what the hell is that?
Well, that's probably Madonna in the 90s, right? She is acting like she invented this. All this actress that she heard saying the word bisexual. They invented being bisexual in the 2000s. And she really sounds and it looks insane. And like she's trying to run for Congress. Like she's going to be your next vice president or something. Or she's trying to sell you a car. Or you know, you don't even drive and she's trying to sell you a truck. That's how much she's trying so freaking hard to be edgy and saying that she got no idea that bisexuality was a thing. It's the same stupidity than saying that she didn't know about drugs. It's the same thing. I mean, it's the same thing. And making it a big deal, like not in the 1800s in England, you know, in Victorian times in America in the 1800s as well. We're not in the back in Salem witch trials. It's no big deal to be bisexual these days. You just, what I'm trying to say is if we cannot really believe anything she says because she contradicts herself so much, so many times in her life. Before the latest, before the Instagram post when she named him as the abuser, she's been contradicting herself over and over and over for a decade about everything. How edgy she was, but then she didn't know what the edge was. But then she was living on the edge. She didn't know what the edge was. And she made a movie about a girl being bisexual, but she didn't felt that she was lonely on this. She was scared. She was not supported. She did nothing about it. Yeah. Okay. My computer's going to die. So, in this. I don't know what coffee is. I don't know what I'm drinking. I have no idea. I should ask Emerald to Wood. I'm going to be back with the next one that is even more laughable than this one.